So I spent weeks building AI agents that worked perfectly, until they didn't. The problem? Well, I had no idea when they broke. Have you ever tried to build your own AI agent, and then you put so much thought into the prompt and your own tests, and it seems to work perfectly, till it's shipped to production and breaks randomly? And then you do a few tweaks, and then nothing works again. And it feels like you're doing this flip and flop just to try to get the best results. If you had this problem, then this video is for you. We're going to talk about how a simple eval system can actually fix all of this, and how you should think about it. Anyway, let's jump straight in. All right, we're going to be talking about how do you actually build reliable AI agents, and a practical way of thinking about evals, or evaluations, in the long term. And let's just jump straight to it. So one thing, you probably have done this before, you have your agent, it's working, and then all of a sudden it isn't. And then you do a few tweaks and it just feels like you're just jumping through so many hoops and you don't really know if it's actually getting better or worse, or you're just, you know, hoping it did get better for that one use case and no one tests any other use cases. Or, you know, your model gets upgraded and then everything that used to work doesn't work anymore and you have to add additional capability and you just don't know where to go. This is where evals come in. It kind of like gives you a nice way to track and see progress when you're building, especially with AI agents, is quite important. So this is the key principle when building with evals. You don't want to say, is this response is good? What is good? Was the tone nice? It's very subjective. We want to be very clear, it's a pass or a fail. So it needs to be a good evaluation. So for example, did this agent call the correct tool? Yes or no? That's a good eval. So you want to try to keep it as qualitative as possible. So you want to make sure your evals are not subjective. You always want to have a definite yes or no. You can have a subjective one, but don't place too much weight on it. Further to that, let's just keep going. Again, you must think of like eval as one thing. You also want to check what's going in and what is the expected output. You kind of want to keep variables very similar to understand if it is improving or not. The reason for this is if you don't do this, you will get various different types of results. So you need to kind of constrain, you know, the variance so you know your tests are independent. Therefore, you know you're making progress or not. So this is just the way to do it. So you actually need to validate what the actual output of that agent is and, you know, have some simple checks what the output is. Another thing I should touch on is if you're building with different agents or different models, the model actually like it behaves differently. So for example, Claude behavior, you know, will follow a very good multi-step order where ChatGPT-4 might actually skip it or reorder them. So you kind of need to make sure the prompt fits the model. Sometimes even like having a markdown versus XML is a better like prompt format for different models. So you need to test this. You really need to understand the real impact. All right, so this is why testing is so critical. You can't just assume. I've fallen in this trap myself. I've thought, okay, I made the best prompt. It should follow everything. And hey, it works maybe for the first few times, and then it breaks. And then I don't know why, and I change something. And then all of a sudden, the prompt behavior is actually way worse than what it was because I was just testing for one case scenario, then just all. And I was getting too tunneled visioned, and I was not really actually building the right model I wanted, or sorry, the right agent I wanted, because I got so tunneled visioned on this one issue that it just didn't do that I made it fix that issue, but then the rest of the issues wasn't as good as it used to be. And this is a common problem. So that's why you really need to think about these eval tests that you have that you can run and make sure that your models actually is improving. All right. So I actually want to talk about what I made in Open Agents, the eval framework. So I've just tried to put different behavior checks in because that's actually what I'm caring about. Because if I can test the behavior, then I understand the prompt is working for my certain agent with the model. So I've got pretty much test data, some checkers, and I'm running my evals. All right, what am I evaluating? Well, I've got an approval gate. Well, I'm calling it an approval gate. So I like to make sure my agent actually asks for approval before it actually edits or executes anything. This way it has to plan and give its thoughts out to me first before just executing. So I have a simple eval check for approval gate. The next one's context loading. Is it actually loading the right file for context first before trying to attempt it? This is another scenario that I test for. Then you know, does the agent read before writing? Sometimes it needs to expect a file before execution. Or lastly, you know, there's certain tools that it maybe should call instead of just falling back to bash. So is it using the right tool for the right scenario? And is it handling errors? So this is more specific for like testing. So if I've got a test, I tell the agent, hey, do a test and fix it. But sometimes I don't always want the agent just to fix it straight away. I want to report back that it encountered an error and this is what it thinks should be the next steps of the solution. Hopefully you see a pattern with how I'm trying to build my agents. I'm trying to do this like approval gating system just because I like the human in the loop. So I build tests around that. All right, on screen, you should see my code base. I'm just going to make it a bit bigger. But essentially, I've made this evals folder here, and you can see I've got different agents. I've been kind of working on a bigger feature for this repo. Mainly, I wanted a way that I could have different prompts for different models. So essentially, you could see I've got my open agents and open coder here. But what I was finding is I was testing for Claude, and some other people were using like Llama or, you know, OpenRouten. They were just getting different results. And I couldn't really change this prompt because it changes everything. And I wanted some way that they could actually make their own prompts and then run it with the same agent, you know, using the same paradigms. So then I just thought, okay, well, I'm going to make this prompt folder here. And I'm just going to break it into the different sections here. So this is like relates back to the agents. I just open the agents, you can see there's all these different folders, sub-agents, etc. And if I go to call here, you can see I've got my open agent and open coder agent. And then in the open agent, I can have different prompts for every different models. And then I can run that. And the same here. So that was one way, you know, I wanted to test for it and get it going. This does take a bit of a workaround, so my eval might be a bit different from your city. Keep that in mind. All right, so for my open agent here, I've made a few tests. I'm not really going to go through all of these because it's quite extensive. A bit weird about my test, like I said, is I've got this eval runner because I'm trying to like copy prompts from different folders to work. This is like my workaround for this repo. If you're building your own, you probably just have a dedicated one that you can just pass the agent in. But I've found this workaround for this repo, so I can test different agents, different prompts, and different models all in one system. So this is a bit more complex, but you'll get the gist. So I'm just going to go to the folder here, and I'm just going to look for my golden tests. So that's in the shared folder. So if I go here, it's the shared tests, and then it's golden. So I'm just going to say golden here. And then it'll only run the golden smoke test. So we can see that there. It's just running that. And I actually want to load this explicit context loading. So we can see here I've named, it needs to follow one of these files here to pass. So oops, type that in. And I'm just going to go back here. Instead of saying smoke test, I'm going to say the 02. All right, so we can see we're testing the context loading explicit here. We can pull the log. So from this, we can see there was 8 events, 1 tool call, tools used was read, and we can check that it actually read the file that we actually cared about. So it read that, and that's pass, and it did a pass. Great. So we can see this final one, it was a pass, and it ran for few milliseconds and had 18 events. This just takes time because it's actually spinning up a server. That's why it's slow. But this is just the way I built it for this repo, and it's worked for me at the moment. One other. All right, if I just want to run the golden, I just have to go here and I just go .yaml. And we can see now it's going to run all 9 of these tests that are already here, and it'll just run in order. What's nice is I can just let this run and then just see how well it did for each of the tests. Again, we're using grok code, so I actually don't expect all of these to pass 100% for this prompt, but we are trying to refine it as much as possible, so it'd be nice to see where it ends up. All right, so I'm going to skip ahead. All right, so if you're back, this is to go through the tests. So we can see it ran all 9 tests. What's nice is I can come through here and actually see what behaviors it did well in. So we can see it passed this validation. This is a smoke test. This one, we needed to know it's actually calling the right context, and it is getting code, so that one passed. And you can also see this one had call details, it had the tests, it had the evals, and it passed all three tests. But we can see here, there is a test failed. So we see a lot of tests have passed. So if we come back to our test results, we can see actually what passed here. So we know the actual error handling pops up first here. It actually handled that quite well. We can see the tool selection actually followed the tools. It did the task breakdown, so complex work. So it did actually do that. Multi-turn context. So this is just like if I prompt it for different things, does it do the right action afterwards? It didn't always write with approval. And this is a funny thing with Grok. It seems like Grok just wants to write code as fast as possible. So this is actually to do with the model. I've tried to really get around this, but I'm still kind of impressed that most others are passing right now. And we can see all the rest are passing. So I know just from this quick run, 8 out of 9 tests passed, which is great. So I can try tweak the prompt now, and with this really try, this just this test fails because it's one test failed. But anyway, so this is great because now I see what tests actually passed or failed, which is great because now I can hone in on the issues that is not working and maybe tweak it to see if it actually works and then run it again to make sure I didn't break anything else. And this way I get a more deterministic approach to make sure first my checks are there and I actually know that if I do ship this, we have some kind of standard that it will work. Right, so why does this like approach even matter? Well, one, you get fast feedback, you know, it's also object measurement, so you can actually measure the progress. So one thing I didn't say earlier with evals is evals is not like you need to get 100% for all of them. It should be your like dream list of getting everything, because there's always going to be something that's going to differ. So you should have some core tests that you always should pass, and then maybe you've got your full list of what everything it should do, and so you tweak that over time to make sure the call keeps going, and then whatever, you know, minor tests after that that you're trying to get closer to gets better and better with time. That's the way you should think about it. So kind of want to track your progress and see if you actually are progressing. And you want to make sure you don't degress, you know. So, you know, make sure if you did have 10 out of 10 passing core tests, and now you got 7, well, you should actually know what broke. If you're saving, like, you know, using a version control system like Git, you should, you know, be able to jump and see what the difference is. So just really think about that. And again, think about this, tests are quite time consuming. So building a really good ground truth data takes time initially, but it really saves you time later on. And, you know, it just allows you to build agents that you can actually know are going to work for your certain test scenarios. Anyway, I hope you found this video useful, just understanding how evals are quite powerful just to build for AI agents, especially for AI tooling. And if you actually do want to contribute or build your own agents, I highly recommend checking out the Open Agents repo. Anyway, again, thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.